Well, the extent of the present crisis is beyond our imagination. Japan has an experience dealing with a similar crisis, although at a bit smaller scale, that extended for 10 or more years. What we learned from that crisis is that transparency is the most important concept, and in that is the key to the governance. In the case of Japan, it was relatively easier because it was a simple real estate bubble case. So we could identify creditors and debtors. Whereas the present crisis, transparency is nowhere existent. The root of the present crisis have been there for so many years, but they have been buried under thick layers of securitized papers and leverages. We have to really dig into financial institutions. We have to strengthen the authority of regulatory authorities and really make a rigorous assessment of these financial institutions' assets. And then we have to differentiate good debts from bad debts. Notion of nationalization should not be excluded, because after all, that was what Japan did to a few number of banks. We can recapitalize banks, and we have to educate and explain to the taxpayers that in the end, this will give us back profit. In case of Japan, the government infused $120 billion of taxpayers' money into banking situation, initially at the resentment of taxpayers, but the government got profit because the value of the preferred stocks of these banks increased, and taxpayers were happy. The government must tell taxpayers that saving banks is not simply to save your deposits, your personal deposits, but the issue is to save companies who are borrowing money from banks. And whether you personally like bank managers or not, this is the central organ of a market economy. So I think the transparency is most important in the global governance before we start salvaging financial institutions. And also, one more thing is that under the new governance, we need more diversities. The number of players have increased, the number of countries have increased. So, for instance, nothing can be decided only among G8 countries. It should be expanded to G13 or G20 if necessary. We share the same stake, and there is an amazing amount of synchronization of global economy. So inclusiveness is going to be another key for the new governance. The United States, the answer is very simple. They originated the problem, so only they can solve the problem. We can stimulate our industry. We can issue a stimulus package one after the other. China has done that. Japan has done that. All over the world, we can do that. And we may be able to bolster the strength of industries. But what is at the heart of this problem is the health and stability of financial institutions. American banks must be brought to sound business activities again. They have to start pumping money into the whole gamut of American industry. And that will only save financial institutions of other countries. It is true that the United States alone cannot revive the world financial institutions, but without the participation of the United States, no solution can be found. Well, there are several problems involved in this. The most vulnerable part of inclusiveness is those unfortunate people who have to live under $2 a day or even $1 a day. And we have enormous number of these unprivileged people who benefit nothing from the concept of globalization. If these people drop out, then there will be no globalization. Globalization advances only to the extent these unprivileged people can come along. So, through the process of globalization, that is more flow of financial capital all over the world, more trades, more exchange of human traffic, and so forth. We have to set aside certain portion of the money flowing into that globalization to lift the living standard of these unprivileged people. Only when we have that massive number of people coming with the globalization can we claim a success. There are other problems as well, like there are outliers and even thugs who try to take advantage or destroy the process of globalization. For instance, failed states, piracy in the Gulf of Aden. Somalia is a failed state. And this is a bit ironical because as the process of globalization progresses, world will come under a universal and sophisticated value system. And participants more and more have to abide by that sophisticated value or civilized principles. Law and order is, of course, the basic element. And so when we see pirates in the Gulf of Aden, well, Japanese ships have been continuously attacked last year, six of them. And we have our fleet there, along with other countries. But this international fleet cannot physically harm pirates because we have to abide by our legal system. For pirates, this is a very low risk, high return business. Youngsters who have been who had been earning only $600 a year are now earning $50,000 after becoming pirates. That's the average income level. And so you have this disconnect or asymmetry, how globalized world can tackle with outliers. The terrorists, they can choose their target and venue of destruction as they like. And so as globalization progresses and we are governed by more and more sophisticated values, because we are on the defending side, we have to amass our defending line. We need more participation to contribute to international security. Japan has to do more, but for instance, BRICS countries, they can do, I think, more. And in this context, it is a welcome thing that China is increasing its participation to United Nations peacekeeping operations. And so, whereas we are heading towards a more integrated, uniform world, the seriousness of really tackling with those unintended consequences of globalization will become more important. I think we have used rhetorics too much, not really thinking about the really effective mechanism to govern the process of globalization. United Nations, obviously the most important security providing organization, is governed by Security Council, where policies can go through only to the extent of five permanent members do not exert their veto. IMF and World Bank, they are valuable institutions, but are we really contributing enough assets to these institutions? G8 summit, yes, we have been gathering since mid-1970s at Rambouillet near Paris, 30 years or more, which has served its purpose well. But when there are so many players, and when, for instance, last year, the contribution of emerging countries and BRICS countries to the growth of the world economy was more than advanced countries, we really need to think if this G7 or G8 should go on forever. It is time to expand the membership. We, for instance, the important BIA, Bank of International Settlement, which provides vital rules for financial transactions. There need to be some room for modifying their rules as well, like the issue of cyclicality problem. When we really make these international institutions to conduct more effective governing, for instance, International Court of Justice. Yes, it sits there with very noble principles, but it is workable only to the extent two parties agree to go to that court, which happens not so often. So when there are so many complex and simultaneous developments taking place at such rapid pace in the international community, we need to transfer more authorities to international institutions.